Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In My Choice to Be My Loving Self presentation, Jesus examines the need to fully express our personality and emotions, to desire connection with the other half of ourselves, the personal priorities we must set, and the choices that we will make to be the most loving expression of ourselves. Recorded on the 11th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay. Oh, on the home stretch now, guys. Get the whip out. nice compassion in that. Yeah, well, the whip's not needed for the horse either. Yeah, okay. So the conversation I'd like to have with you now is my choice to be my loving self. And remember, the previous one we had this morning was the choice to develop my loving self. And this one's more about, like, what are you going to choose to be right now? What are you going to choose to do right now? Development requires a process that is engaged over time. Being requires you to change some of the ways in which you use your will immediately, if you can. Now, of course, that's not always going to be possible because there's, you know, these things have to be worked through, but even being some of these things is going to help you work through them by being them rather than just skipping over them, living in the facade of them. So we want to examine what we need to do to be our loving selves on a daily basis. The first thing I'd like to raise with you is the issue of your priorities. What are your priorities? Remember, these are will-based priorities. These are not willpower-based priorities. And remember, we said this morning in the first group we had this morning that and the choice to develop my loving self, we talked about the difference between the willpower being exercised and the will being exercised. And frequently, the will being exercised is about undoing things rather than doing things. Does that make sense? And particularly when it comes to the aspect of sin and all of its subsequent results. It's a lot about undoing things. So as you can see with my priorities, if we don't have these priorities, I'm not suggesting to you to use your willpower to create them. What I'm suggesting to you is to change some of these things that are going on and some of the things from your real self so that you can develop these priorities over a period of time, so that when we come to our next group or a few groups after that, you're actually in a stage where you are being your loving self rather than just hoping to be. Right? So the first priority number one, relationship with God. And in fact, we could just write it as God is my number one priority, couldn't we? If God is not your number one priority on a daily basis, you will not progress anywhere near as rapidly as you could progress if God was your number one priority. And if God is your number one priority, you'll be drawn into addressing what sin creates and sin itself, the desire to sin itself. You'll be drawn into addressing it. You won't only address these things because you're in pain. You'll address them because it's the right thing to do. It's the truthful thing to do. It's the best thing to do, not only for you, but for everyone around you as well. You see, most of the time we have a very selfish perspective. We're only interested in our own happiness. We're not that concerned about the happiness of others. And when you have God as your priority, well, God's concerned about the happiness of everyone, everyone's happiness equally. So God's not going to help you sacrifice another person's happiness for the sake of your own. Right? So this is why, another reason why God as your number one priority will draw you through everything, everything you need to address and deal with. Number two priority, yourself. And by yourself, I mean not just yourself, but the other half of yourself. So many of you have placed a priority, for many of you, your priorities are self and then self and then, oh, yourself. And then, oh, yeah, self too. That's, you know, that's your priority, you know. And that priority is always going to end up with a deep level of unhappiness for self, but also for others. And by self there, you really are doing half self. That's really your priority, right? And what I'm suggesting here is your priority needs to change so that you're concerned about not only yourself, but the other half of yourself. So what happens if the other half of yourself is in a worse condition than you are? They know less than you do about truth. Can you see that they are very dependent upon you doing something for their sake as well as your own? Do you see what I'm saying? Which is all really just for your own sake in the end, but they're dependent upon that, right? As a part of their progression. So it helps you be less selfish, ironically, when you're fully focused on your full self. Because for the majority of people, full self only means one individual, but I'm talking about full self meaning two people, you and the other half of you. And for most people, you know, as soon as they've got to consider another person, they automatically have to start looking at their own selfishness. So that's it's a great thing that God's designed to help us address issues of personal selfishness. So self, very important, that is a priority. Now, like, we can talk about how we make God a priority, and how do we do that? We certainly don't do it by, you know, talking to God once or twice a day or not at all. We don't do it by ignoring most of God's laws, do we? We'd have to engage them, wouldn't we? We'd have to want to know them. We don't do it by spending most of our time just playing or playing with things without actually experiencing God in the process of play. So we don't do it by ignoring God. We do it by engaging God in a process. We talked about that in the previous talk, so we don't need to talk about that now. We just need to see that it needs to be a priority. It needs to be the first priority. And self needs to be the next, because without you changing self, you can't actually really properly love anybody, really, right? And unless yourself becomes less selfish, then it's highly unlikely that you'll be able to love the environment, anybody else, or God. So we need to develop ourselves. It's not actually, we're not talking about a selfish development of self here. We're talking about the development of self to get to God's condition of what is love and truth. And that means that we're going to have to become more selfless than we currently are. For the majority of us, that's what it's going to mean. Right? Very important to put that next. You can't also put others before yourself, I've found, because in the end, you can't help anybody else unless you've helped yourself first. You know, a lot of people ask me, why is it that I'm not healing other people, right, yet? And the answer is quite simple, because I haven't healed myself yet. It would be both wrong and hypocritical to try or attempt to heal others while at the same time ignoring development of myself, right? And we often see this in a relationship where you want the other person to change first, right? And that's not what God's asking you to do. God's asking you to change first. And if you change first, then other people can be assisted to change, right? So that's why it needs to happen that we actually learn to place as a priority loving self. See, this is about loving God. This is about loving self. And then the third priority is loving others. Dealing with issues that prevent us from loving others. Now, when you start looking at the facade and you accept your facade, you get to this point where you see quite clearly, wow, these are all the things I do where I don't love myself. And quite often it's complete reversal of what you thought before that. You know, you thought you weren't loving yourself when you actually were, and you thought you were loving yourself when you actually weren't, you know, and you see that in the end. And the same applies with others. You quite often frequently think that others are not loving you when they actually are. And quite often you think that others are loving you when they're actually not. And all of that needs to be reversed. But unless we deal with these issues with regard to our love of others as a priority, we're never going to address them. Because once we've dealt with self, we think, oh, everything's fixed and it's not going to be fixed. And in fact, a relationship with God is not actually fully possible unless you address your love of others. Ironically, also, your love of God is not actually completed until you also addressed your love of everything else, really, which is, let's call it, the environment. Many of you have some severe problems with that. It's very low priority in your life, much, much lower than number four, where you're not caring of the environment, you even hardly consider it. You see your environment as something that serves you, and therefore you should be able to abuse it at any time and not worry about it. And you certainly have very, very little desire to fix it, for many of you. You rave on about others not doing damage to it, but you do not much at all personally to fix it. And these are part of your priorities if you love. So you love God first, you love yourself next, take action to love yourself next, you love others, and then you love your environment. And none of these loves are actually exclusive. They're not mutually exclusive, they are mutually inclusive. In other words, I can't love God unless I love the environment. I can't love God unless I love others. I can't love God unless I love myself. That's the beauty of this priority system, is that each of the list things in the priority will draw you to this way in which you love, which is like universal. It affects everything you do rather than just a few things you do. So that's very powerful, looking at your priorities. And remember, if you notice that your priorities are out of line to that, you know, it's like I said here, self, 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 and self, then instead of trying to use your willpower to change that, you need to address the underlying reasons why it's like that. Does that make sense? Allow yourself to see what the motivations are for it to be to ignore God or ignore self or ignore others. What is the underlying addictions in place? And, you know, you need to let yourself examine those things and feel about those things so that your will can change. So don't try changing these things with your willpower. Look at your priorities honestly. Ask yourself whether they are the priorities in your life or not. And if they're not, change them, but change them using the techniques we've discussed with you, going through the emotional reasons why they're not like that. Developing even an aspiration to go through the emotional reasons why they're not is going to be better than doing nothing. Is there any questions about the priorities? Very simple priorities, I feel like. Very simple priorities. You have those priorities, it's very hard to go wrong with your development. Very hard. But as soon as you let's say you focus on self first. So you put number two, and instead of being number two, you make it number one. The problem with that is when you are happy with you, you'll stop. You'll stop development. You'll stop even, you know, growing to be more loving. You'll stop. Because you'll be satisfied with what you are, but it doesn't mean that it's the best you can be, and it doesn't mean that other people be happy with it. And it doesn't mean your environment is going to be very happy about it. It just means that you are. So that's the flaw. If we just focus on self. If we just focus on others, very similar. Once others are happy, we stop. If we focus on the environment, which is really hard to do, you know, and just focus on that, if you just focus on that, you're never going to be happy. You know why? Because other people destroy the environment that you have tried to create in a more loving space, and you will always be disappointed. In addition to that, you, through your own unloving actions towards yourself and others, will probably also affect the environment, and therefore you're sort of working against yourself. So any other priority than those priority systems, that priority system has got all sorts of logical problems with it. So those are my priorities. Now let's examine my choices. Just rub that out. A bit of deep breathing. So let's examine the choices that we need to make. Now, here I'm not going to list all the choices that we need to make, because a lot of them are going to be very, very similar, aren't they, to the choice to develop my loving self in order to be my loving self. But here I'd like to focus your attention on three things that I notice are general problems that I observe that people don't engage in their in terms of just how they are or how they be, how they act in any given situation. The first one is that, and it's difficult to do this if you haven't received God's love, right? So you need to have received God's love to do it, but is to actually live in harmony with the love that you receive. The interesting thing about the human will is that you can actually receive God's love and at the same time choose to live out of harmony with it. If you do it, you'll find you'll develop for yourself a lot of pain, because the love that's in you will be constantly triggering this pain, because it's different to what you're doing and acting and feeling. And remember, God's love affects your feelings, so your feelings, if you act out of harmony with what God's love has affected, it means you're acting out of harmony with true feelings. And the only reason for doing that is going to be this, isn't it? Addictions or fear, terror, avoidance of pain. They're the only reasons why you would choose to do such a thing. If you live in harmony with God's love, and let's also add to that, and laws, and remember that living in harmony with God's laws is living in harmony with God's love, right? If you live in harmony with God's laws, now God's laws are supporting you to be you. Everything that happens today, if you lived in harmony with God's laws today, everything that happened today would also be in harmony with the outcomes of God's laws lived, which will all be positive outcomes. What I notice a lot of people choosing to do is they live out of harmony with God's laws during the course of a day. Oftentimes they know they are, and they still do it. Now, you can't hope to progress while you're creating more sin. You're just going to have more pain to release at some point in the future. So what I'm suggesting is we need to stop sinning as far as we're able at any point in time. That's something that a choice we can make right now. A choice to stop sinning as far as we can recognize what sin is at this point. Many of us are not even doing that. We know we're sinning while we're doing it many times, but we still feel like doing it. And instead of developing our will, we're just stopping and just going, hang on a sec, what I need to do now is find out why I feel like doing it and attempt to remove whatever that causes so that I can stop. Because unless I do that, every new day is a new sin. Every new sin is new pain. And therefore, progression is going to be much more difficult. Now, I've drawn that little map for you before, how many of us are doing this over the course of a year, where we try to do some development, we release some emotion that's negative, that's out of harmony with love, that's about addiction or whatever. And then we get to a point where we're triggered with an event, because God's trying to help us grow, so naturally we're attracting events through the law. But instead of actually acting in harmony with the law of love, we actually decide in that moment to act out of harmony with it. And so what happens is we regress in our condition, right? And maybe we don't regress that much, but usually we go back to similar to our original condition. And now we're going to have to release that pain that we just created. And then hopefully what we want to do to progress is to release some more pain and release some more pain eventually, right? Or at least to not engage sin. If we engage sin, we go back down again each time. So many of us have spent years doing this. And then we look back over seven years and we go, gee, I haven't progressed much. That must be Jesus' fault because he mustn't be teaching us the right thing. And I'm saying, hang on a sec. The only reason why you're in pain is because of sin, right? It's not me, unless I've sinned against you. The only reason why you're in pain is because of the sin you've chosen to engage. And I'm suggesting to you this is what happens to the majority of us. Now, wouldn't it make more sense to do this? You do a bit of progress, and even if you just stay there and every time there's an event, you at least even stay in the same place. That would be good, wouldn't it? At least that. Rather than choosing the sin and making it our condition go down again. And if we can do that and then you deal with another emotion, it might be even a few months later, you end up over a year where you've actually progressed, right? Instead of it being like this. All right. So that's why we need to choose to live in harmony now. Whatever you know about God's love now, choose to do it now. Stop putting it off. Stop saying, I'll do that when I get around to it. Stop saying, I'll do that when I feel better about myself. Stop saying, I'll do that when I don't want one of my addictions met. You know, I'll do it sometime later. 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 If you keep saying later, you'll die saying later. And then you'll pass in the spirit world and you'll still be saying later. Right? Remember the spirits that came to us yesterday who asked about, I want to keep going the natural love way for a while longer. Well, that's just saying later. Later. It's not now. Not now. And I'm saying in order to be my loving self, I choose to do things now. Whatever I know I need to do, I do now. I don't avoid it. I don't put it off. Makes sense, right? But most of us don't do it. We put it off. We're masters at putting things off, aren't we? What is it called? Procrastination. Right. I don't procrastinate. I just leave everything till tomorrow. That's what we do, isn't it? We don't even tell ourselves that that's what we're doing, putting it off. Yeah. So live in harmony with what, you know, God's love dictates. And you don't know at this stage everything that God's love or God's laws are. That's okay. Just do what you know is in harmony. At least that. Do you know what I mean? At least that. So if you know that getting angry and throwing things at people is not a good thing, then don't get angry, then don't throw at them. Go outside and bash a baseball bat against a boxing bag or something instead. At least do something different, you know, that doesn't involve harming somebody else or yourself for that matter, you know. You know that every time you hit yourself or you punish yourself for an action you're taking, it just makes your life worse. So stop doing it. Look at, and to stop doing it, you're going to have to get to the emotional reason why you do it. So develop a will to get to that emotional reason now. Don't put it off till tomorrow. Look that it happened today, so deal with it today. Makes sense, right? Okay. What's the next thing I'd like to talk to you about? Your choices. Well, it's about the issue of the influences that you're under. Like many of you are so addicted to inspiration that you don't really care where you get your inspiration from, you know? And so that means that you go and ask people who are not loving, what would you do? And they go, I'll do this, I'll do that. And you go, oh, yeah, that sounds reasonable. I'll go and do that. Instead of going, hang on a sec, what's the point of asking a person who I know is unloving about something that I want to be more loving about? No point. So accept influences that are loving. Don't accept influences. So accept loving influences. I see many of you rejecting loving influence. You're doing the opposite and reject unloving influences. Many of you are doing this with spirits, right? You want an addiction met with a spirit, so you do what the spirit wants. He gives you their, or she gives you their response to that. Your addiction is met, their addiction is met, but you've just sinned again, doing what they wanted. You'd be far better off rejecting their influence, even if they're going to attack you, even if you're going to feel bad for a few days. And the same applies to people on earth. Like someone on earth comes along and says, let's go and do this. And you go, it's not really where I want to be and it's not really where I want to be going. But I'll go along because I want their approval or I want their acceptance or whatever it is I want from them. So I go along. That's me accepting an unloving influence rather than rejecting it. Many of you do it with information coming at you from the internet or from television or from the media. You listen to this information that you know is either incomplete or completely wrong, and you're sitting there listening to it. Why? It's just an unloving influence, right? You'd be far better off watching a documentary on science or something than you would doing that. Spending your time, if you want to sit down and relax, spending your time, you know, enjoying something that will actually build your faith or build your confidence or build some measure of truth, even if it's just some physical truth. You'd be better off doing that than accepting the unloving influence which comes from the media, which is a lot to do about manipulation, control, and particularly the triggering of your fear, constantly trying to get you to live in fear. Live in fear. You know, the message from the world is, you know, it's a neon sign, live in fear, blink, 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 live in fear, you know, and it's coming at you from all places, from lots of people. Now, for some of you, those people are your family members saying, live in fear, that's a bad influence. You know, if your family's saying, don't live in fear, that's a good influence. You know, you spend time with your family if they're saying, don't live in fear. But if they're saying, live in fear, you've got to start drawing a line somewhere and say, no, I can't keep spending time with you while you got this coming at me all the time. This is a bad influence on my life. I'm trying to get to the stage where I want to love only and not live in fear. And you're just trying to barrage me with your fear and try to get me to live your way. When am I going to stop doing that? And I look at, why am I spending time with my family just when they are doing this to me? Obviously, I've got other addictions. I need to address them, because if I was really wise, I would actually reject the unloving influence no matter who it's coming from. It doesn't matter whether it's family, friends, children, parents, whatever, workmates, whatever. I'd say, no, I'm not interested in that. Wouldn't I? Of course I wouldn't. So you can see that I'm going to have to make some choices to be, right now, be my loving self. And this can happen. These are everyday choices, just what happens in the moment, each day. I notice someone's trying to influence me into fear or into doing something out of harmony with love. I reject the influence. I notice somebody's trying to help me, influence me in a positive direction through giving me assistance and some inspiration. Instead of rejecting their influence, I'd be better off accepting it. And by accepting it, I mean acting upon it, not just going in one ear and, you know, a bit of cogs go around a bit, churn that over and spit it out the other ear. None of that. Right? We would actually do something with it. Act upon it now. You know? I find many of my conversations with people are about their emotions. We have a conversation about their emotions, and while we're having the conversation, they are trying hard to not feel that emotion. And then I watch them go away, and for weeks and weeks and weeks, they do nothing about that emotion. And then they come back for additional help. And I'm going, well, hang on a sec. Why would I give you additional help? You're not just wasting my time. If you're not prepared to deal with the emotion that we've identified in the previous discussion, then what's the point in addressing more emotions that you're not going to probably identify? right? And people who love you are not going to waste their time with you. They're not. Right? And if you loved them, you wouldn't waste their time either by asking them question after question that's the same question you asked last time. And many of you have done this with me, right? Question after question after question, same question, not wanting to address the emotion. A loving person accepts the loving influences of loving people and acts upon them. A loving person rejects the unloving influence of other people and does not act upon them. Does not act upon the suggestions of unloving people. That's choice. We've got choice. Every moment we can make those choices. And again, it's based upon what you believe is loving and what you believe is unloving. And God knows that. But at least you're having an effort to actually determine what is loving and what is unloving and accept the loving and reject the unloving. Being, trying to be yourself in the moment and be what your goals are in the moment. Yep. So is there any questions about that? No, pretty clear? Yep. You notice today you haven't got many questions? Yep. You know why? Some said they're not there yet. Well, partly. But partly because a lot of what I'm talking about today is very different to what I was talking about yesterday. Yesterday I was talking about what God's given you. So now we had a focus away from you and onto God. Today our focus has come back onto you. And what happens when our focus is back on us?
No.
Yeah. I shouldn't rub out my choices because I want to talk to you about your choice to be your personality, to identify and be who you really are. Express. Well, actually, I might put it, yeah, so I think the heading on the in the book is actually expressing myself, so I might call it that so that... So the first thing in expressing yourself is learn, feel who you feel to be, what you feel to be doing at any one moment in your day, and do it and be it. Feel what you feel. Feel your emotion right now, whatever that emotion is, and choose to be it. Be it rather than denying it's there. Right? So if you feel unhappy, what you would do if you did this, if you felt unhappy right now, you'd cry. Because you're choosing to be whatever you feel right now. And if that's cry, then you cry. Now, if you feel happy or you feel like it's just something was funny, you choose to be you no matter what, no matter who's around, and you'd laugh. Like, even if it was in the middle of like an audience or something and nobody else laughed, you thought it was funny, you'd laugh. You follow? You would. If you choose to be in this right now, in this moment, whatever you're feeling right now, you would be it. That's what it means to be yourself as a person right now in this instant. We're trying to focus your attention on what's happening right now. So what do you feel right now? Do you think? Just let yourself breathe diaphragmatically into your tummy, into your chest, as much as air you can get in, and breathe in and out for a bit and feel what you feel. Like, just allow yourself to feel what you feel. Stop tuning out of what you feel. What do you feel? Now, is that happy, sad, whatever? Just let it be. Even if it don't have to let it just wash over you maybe here, but let yourself acknowledge, yeah, when AJ starts talking about myself stuff, I just go, here we go again. It's all my failings, all the things I've got to do. I'm sick of hearing about it, really. Honestly, if that's what you felt, I'd prefer that you express that. So you don't think I'd prefer that, but I do. Because if you express that, I could deal with that. But when you push that away, you know how you go? It's like, in here, it's... out there, it's and it hardly reaches there, right? Hardly reaches your eyes. Right? And you're there masking what you feel, purposefully. It's a purposeful action, yeah? So, Sandra, you'd like to ask? Have we got a mic? Yep.
Jesus, I wanted to ask you, for a long time, in the past few days, you've mentioned the feeling of saying how are you to someone or something like that, and then you said, but the real feeling is I want to kill you.
Yeah.
And so my question is, would you actually say that? I've been pondering that, like, because if the emotion behind it is angry.
What I'm suggesting is, if you be yourself, Sandra, feel like you want to kill somebody, and I suggest that's a pretty strong emotion, obviously driven by some rage, you would sit with that and you'd acknowledge that, and you go, yeah, actually, I can't say to them, how are you? Because I actually feel quite negative towards this person. And what I really need to do is go away, feel this feeling of why I feel so upset with this person, and try to get to the bottom of it. Does that make sense? But at least honour the feeling, right? Stop making out that you're actually interested in their welfare, because you're not. You see what I'm saying? You know, whenever you make out, you're now in the facade, you're presenting pretty face to the person, but the reality is you're feeling something quite different. Now recognize when it's unloving and do something about it. But see, you're not going to do anything about it unless you first feel, right? And certainly taking the action to present the thing to them, right, is certainly out of harmony with love. It makes it worse. It's lying to them now, right? So you would stop that, because it's an unloving act. To lie to somebody is unloving. You don't have to go and tell them that you feel that way about them, because that would also feel like an attack, would it not, on them, which would also be an unloving act. So go away and feel what you feel. Allow yourself to feel it. But stop thinking that you don't, and stop putting on the pretty face when you don't feel like doing it. Do you know what I mean? These things have to cease right now. You can stop them now. You can stop this will help you see the truth of what's going on, if you do it now. But if you put it off and you go, yeah, no worries, and you're talking, isn't it a wonderful day, and act like you're interested in this person that you're not interested in at all, then what you're doing is you're falsifying, even to yourself, how you feel. And as we've said, lying to yourself is the worst thing you can do, because you're not going to progress then. Does that make sense, Sandra?
Thank you very much for that.
Yeah. So if you've got negative emotion, let yourself feel it. And to be honest, in these groups here, what we're trying to do is create an environment where you can express yourself even if you have a negative emotion. However, I'm not going to put up with you expressing yourself in that way as if I'm to blame for it, because that would just be feeding your addiction to blame somebody else rather than take responsibility for your emotion. So what I'm suggesting is you don't force other people to be responsible for now what you feel. I'm suggesting you take responsibility for what you feel and feel it now, right now, every moment, every day, all the time. So you're driving in a car with your partner. She says, I want to get a coffee. You feel angry that you got to stop. Feel. Yeah, no worries. We'll stop. When inside you're going, why do I have to bloody stop again? I'm sick of stopping for this. Why doesn't she deal with this coffee addiction that she's got? God, you know, instead of feeling all those things without saying it, feel what you feel. And if you have a really honest relationship, you'll be able to even state that in a more loving way than I've just said it, of course. You'll be able to state, I always feel that we have to stop for you, your addiction. That's all you have to say, right? Feel what you feel, and where possible, express it. Right? If it's loving expression, then express it. If it's not a loving expression, go away by yourself if you can manage it. And a lot of times you can. Go away by yourself and feel, wow, it's pretty unloving feelings there. All of God's laws are trying to correct my feelings, so I need to work in harmony with this. I've got a pretty unloving feeling there. I need to address this feeling. But see, if you don't feel your feeling in the moment, you're definitely not going to address it. Makes sense, huh? Okay, so being part of expressing myself is expressing my real emotion. Now, I'm not suggesting you damage other people with your real emotion. I'm saying express it. So in other words, if I feel really damaged emotion towards Alex, instead of expressing it to Alex, I'll go into my room and express my emotion. This is how I feel, so I express it, right? And then I get to the bottom of it if it's unloving. But if I don't express it and I don't feel it, I'll never get to the bottom of it, right? But if I know, hang a sec, no, I feel real warmth for Alex. If I want to give him a hug, but he doesn't look like he wants a hug from me, but I want to give him one, right? Then you'd try to express it. But you'd also be aware of whether he wants it or not. If you're a bit more emotionally open, you'd feel whether he wants it or not. Sometimes I feel like hugging you, you know, and I feel like, yeah, you don't want it yet, so I'll put it off. Expressing real emotion based on love, we're talking here. But be real about it. Stop, you know, stop making out that it's not there. It's not how you feel. Amber?
I feel like a majority of people, myself included, feel very uncomfortable in like social situations where there's lots of people around, and then I'm sort of stuck with the feeling like, okay, should I just leave this feeling inside of me until I get home, or should I run into the bathroom and punch the door? I don't know.
Well, if you're really into expressing your feelings and letting your feelings go, you'd find if you feel like punching something, then you'd go and find something safe to punish and punch it, wouldn't you?
Well, see, I probably wouldn't. I'd just stay in that awkward situation, and because I feel
if you store the emotion, Amber, you're going to have to deal with it at some other point. So many of you are storing an emotion and then not dealing it with the other point at another point. And isn't that the same as what happened in your childhood? Store an emotion, not dealing with it at all. Storing another emotion, not dealing with it at all. That just adds to your pain. You need to release emotion to release pain. So if there is a painful situation right at the moment happening, you're far better off releasing the emotion than storing it. I find it remarkable, you know. I've been watching a show. I love documentaries, right? One of the documentaries I've been watching is called Air Crash Investigations. And it's interesting watching it because there's some people who were the families of people who had died in the crash talking about the event. Now, these events happened, many of them happened 20 years ago or even longer. And one we watched the other night happened something like 26 years ago, 25 years ago. And the dad of the daughter, he was still choking down his tears 25 years later. And I'm going, I said to Mary, people just don't want to cry. They just don't let themselves have a good ball. And he obviously hasn't let himself have a good ball about his daughter's death for 25 years. And all he needs to do is have a good ball about it, and he'll feel better and he'll act differently and everything will start changing for him. He'll release some pain. But no, because he's been taught to store it and desensitized from it, it's all stored in there. And he starts talking to the air crash investigator and he can barely control his tears talking about the actual crash. Does that make sense? 25 years after it. Man, it's just like, how complex is that? Storing an event for years and years and years and years, and every time you talk about it, you only release a dribble. It's going to take hundreds of years to release one emotion like that. And this is what our problem is, Amber. We keep storing them rather than dealing with them. And every time you choose in the moment to store an emotion, you're going to find it much harder later to actually access it. You are.
This could be some childhood emotion coming up, but if you feel like it's an inappropriate time to address the emotion because there's lots of people around and you've got to be all bubbly and happy for the event or something, would you just go home after the event?
Well, for a start, it doesn't apply to my events, does it? Because I don't expect you to be bubbly and happy. So it doesn't apply to these events when you're learning about this stuff. Doesn't apply. So it only applies to other events. And my suggestion is still the same. whenever you store the emotion, you're making a choice to put off dealing with the emotion till a later time, and you're now consigning yourself to having to address that pain at some point in your future. That's what you're doing. Now, if you want to continue doing that, that's your choice. I'm just saying that every time you do it, for whatever reason, whether you're scared of people or scared of how they'll treat you or whatever the reason is, it doesn't really matter what the reason is. I'm just saying every time you store the emotion, it's going to have to be dealt with at some point later.
And did you personally go nuts or something at an event with lots of people, or did...
No, I haven't had to, because I've released my emotion at home when I'm by myself, which you don't do.
Okay.
So it's like, it's sort of like, if you're in the moment at home most of the time, you're in an environment that is under your control, you can release emotion at any time. You choose to release most of your emotion in that setting. How much emotion are you going to have left to deal with when you're in public? Hardly any, right?
But at home, there's not lots of people around to judge me.
You still didn't hear what I said.
Sorry.
You didn't hear what I said. You have an emotion, whatever it is, at home. You can have them at home or anywhere else, right? At home, there's no people around, so you release the emotion. Will that emotion need to be released when you're around people now? No, because it's already done.
But I feel scared around people, and at home there is no people, so I'm just like, oh, I'm okay.
No, I'm suggesting to you, Amber, you're not hearing me still. I'm suggesting to you, you don't release emotion at home. And therefore, there's a whole heap of emotion that when you're around people gets triggered, and then you store it again to try to go home to release it. But when you get home, you don't get to release it because it's already gone by then. So you end up storing more and storing more and storing more.
So that's where a soul space becomes very important.
Well, it's not only the soul space, it's your attitude at home that matters a lot. You're at home, like most people are at home more than they're anywhere else. Most people are by themselves a lot of the time, but we in that place choose to store emotion rather than feel it. And as a result, we get triggered by events when we're with people, and then we store it there too. And in the end, what happens? We end up not feeling anything. But no more questions for you, because I need to keep going.
I was just going to say, I use my kids as an excuse not to feel it when I'm at home as well.
But now we're talking about your personal story. Yep. So that's what I knew was coming next, and I wanted to prevent that. Thanks, Sherry.
So this is how we also get to know and feel more of our personality that God has given us.
Correct. All your personality is tied up in your emotion.
So the more you can feel how you really feel is also the way that others get to know us, and we get to know ourselves and
Correct.
Be real.
And people don't have to guess how you feel. They can see how you feel. Mm. I love it with Mary, because it's written all over her face. I know how she feels. It's real easy, right? A lot of times I see it before she does, of course, because I'm more sensitive to it. But it's a lot better to know how somebody feels and see it than it is to be guessing all the time. Most of you in relationships spend half of your life guessing what the other person feels. Mm. Oh, does she feel this, or she did feel that, or what did she think? What did she feel there? What did she think there? Well, I don't know, because both of you are not expressing yourselves in the moment. Does that make sense? This is what I feel. This is what I think about that. That's all you got to do. But what happens? Fear kicks in, your facade kicks in, and instead of doing that, you're doing a whole heap of other things. And what I'm suggesting is this is a choice in the moment. I can express myself in the moment. I can choose to be myself in the moment. I can feel my emotions in the moment and be myself. And particularly when I'm home, particularly when there's no one around me or just my family around me, that's when I need to be doing this. But most of us aren't. We're not. We're having this little silent inner world that we live in that nobody else knows. Even we don't really know it. We're just living in it. You get that? Even we don't know it, because we're not even honouring the emotion and feelings we have. Laura?
So even like if we deny, like for myself feeling grumpy, which I feel, the go through the denial techniques just of actually feeling why I don't actually just want to let people see that I'm grumpy.
Yeah.
It's a whole process in itself.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah, it exposes the reason for the facade, right? Doesn't it, Laura? It's like, I don't want to show on my face that I'm grumpy, So, yeah. That doesn't reach here. I'm smiling. Or just try to be as blank as I can, you know. Like,
yeah, even by myself.
Is there any wrinkles there that display what I feel? No, that's good.
Yeah.
You know, what we need to do is allow ourselves, our body and everything to feel what it feels. You don't have to dump it on others, but you do need to learn to just be what you feel in the moment, right? And particularly when you're in family situation and at home by yourself, you need to do it then. And let's face it, that's a lot of our time. You know, when we're alone working, we can do it then too. Just there's a lot of time that we can do this, but we're using excuses already and go, oh, but there's people around it, oh, but this and oh, but that. And I'm saying, but hang on a sec, a lot of your time is by yourself. A lot of the time is just with your family or what you call your friends, and yet you're not doing it. And I'm suggesting to be your loving self, you need to learn to do it. It also is more loving to others because they get to see without having to guess. They get to feel without having to guess. Isn't that more loving? So I don't have to ask you how you feel. Well, it's easy for me because I can feel it anyway. But for the average person, they don't have to even ask how you feel. See it on your face. So if Justin looks grumpy, I think Justin's grumpy. What are you grumpy about, mate? You know, that you can say that instead of having to say, what are you feeling? I don't even know what you're feeling. You know, and it's far better is go like, look at his face and he's displaying how he feels, and you know he's grumpy. He might even be muttering under his breath and swearing away and whatever. And yeah, he's pretty grumpy. So I know he's grumpy then, right? I don't have to guess what he's feeling. I know he's feeling it. He's grumpy or he's upset about something. And most of the time I'll also probably see what it's about, even in that circumstance. So that helps him, because it helps him get away from his facade and actually know what's going on. Helps me, because I know that he's in some emotion that I don't have to worry about. It's his emotion. But I know he's in some emotion and he's feeling it, and that's fantastic. And I don't have to guess what it is and work around it, because he's telling me or he's showing me. It's much more loving. So that's what we do. Very important to express your real emotion in the circumstance. And the same applies, of course, to your personality, expressing personality. Now, that might take a little bit more time for many of you, because at this stage you don't really know what your personality is, right? So, that's probably going to require getting rid of some facades and get addictions and probably even addressing some of this terror, because this terror is all about masking your true personality, right? But once you get to that point, be in the moment your personality. There's people who won't like it and there's people who will. Stop being addicted to everybody liking you and just be yourself, right? The reality is that anybody who loves will love you being yourself. So if anybody around you doesn't like you being yourself, they already don't know how to love. Yep, Sherry?
So feeling emotion is only one way of getting to know your personality more. So yep. What are some of the other ways you might get to know your personality better?
Well, you're going to have to deal with this terror, as I said.
Right, okay.
Right. Unless you deal with the terror, right, you're not going. The terror is all about not being your real personality,
right?
Okay. Not being your real self. So unless you deal with the terror, you're probably going to have compulsions all the time to not be your real self. Mm-hmm. Now, but there are other times when you can feel your real self, right? You get enthusiastic about something, and instead of going enthusiastic about it, what do? Yeah, no, I'm cool. Inside, you're going, oh, it's so good. Inside, you know, oh, I'm cool. Isn't that what we do? We don't want to show too much, emotion, because people then know, they're really happy about that. I'll have to do that for them less. You know, we're worried about other people and how they'll respond to our happiness, and some respond negatively and some respond positively, but we don't know that, and most of the time we don't know what they'll do. So what we do is we try to make everything's fine, don't we? And then if you examine it, we do that with a lot of things, don't we? It's like, example, majority of you, majority of you ladies in particular, when you're horny, you don't let your husbands know. You wait for him to work it all out for you. You do. Because you don't want to be perceived as a slut or someone who's a bit out there sexually or whatever, because oftentimes that is the case. So many of you do this. You don't let him even know. You don't show through your actions. Right? So these are all things that you're doing that are just masking your true nature. Like, why do you do that? Because you're afraid of taking a risk. You might be afraid of him rejecting you in that moment or whatever. There might be a lot of emotions that come up, you know, if he does reject you in that moment and so forth, right? And then others of you do the opposite of that. So you're not feeling horny and he does, and you go, oh, I'll go along with it. Right? Because why? You're trying to manage his emotion. You're trying to manage how he feels. You're trying to make him feel okay with you. You don't want his anger. You don't want his, you know, for being rejected or whatever. Right? You don't. So you don't, not honest, you just go along. So quite often you go along with people around you to meet certain addictions of your own, and or you don't display your true nature for the same reason, because it meets certain addictions of your own. And what I'm suggesting is, if you display your true nature and how you feel in each moment, it will help you deconstruct your addictions. It'll help you. It'll help you see what's going on. Right? This addiction for making your husband happy even when you're not that happy. Or the addiction to not let him be happy even when you would like to be. They're all driven by different addictions. So let yourself feel what you feel and act upon what you feel rather than just shutting it down. You see what I'm saying? Very important thing, expressing. And once you do that more and more, you'll start to be who you are. And by the time you've got through this terror, you'll start recognizing wonderful parts of your personality. You'll be expressing it. Other people will be enjoying your company. And then there's other people who will be like hopping mad every time they see your face. They will, because, you know, they can't bear that you're happy. Or they can't bear that you have this enthusiasm for whatever, music or art or whatever it is that you're enthusiastic about, right? And they'll be unhappy, but you don't care anymore. You're expressing yourself emotions unashamedly without reserve. You're being open and transparent. You don't worry about that anymore. But here, you worry about it. At this point of refusal of terror, you're worried. But you don't worry anymore. Once you've dealt with that, you don't worry about what it looks like to other people. Like, I jump around like an idiot sometimes in front of you. I don't care what you think about me. I don't. Why would I? It's who I am, and I'm showing you, but I'm being loving to you by expressing who I am. You don't have to guess who I am. You don't have to try hard to, you know, dig under all the facade to find out who's the real Jesus, right? And I'm suggesting you need to do the same yourself. Make sense? Yeah. Very important part of being yourself right now. Learning how to express yourself. And expressing yourself means taking risks. And you can see that every time you take a risk, you are actually triggering fear, right? This is good for you. This helps you identify your fears. It helps you identify your addictions if you take risks. And the biggest risk you need to take, obviously, to help identify this terror, this global terror, is the risk of being you. And if you can do that, you'll find that terror a lot faster than if you just go around trying to be what everybody else wants you to be, or to be more accurate, being what you believe everybody else wants you to be. Because that's really all we're doing. We don't even know. You know, we spend half of our life being what the other person wants, and half the time they don't even want it. But we don't know that. So we keep doing it. So it's a big problem for us. So the other thing we needed to talk about was, and there's a whole heap of things about lovingly expressing our emotion or removing from ourselves the unloving expression of emotion and lovingly expressing our personality and so forth and the situations in which we do so. So for example, there's issues with regard to when I share myself compared to when I be myself. There's a difference there. Maybe we need to talk about that for a little bit. What does it mean to be myself and what does it mean to share myself? Well, it's an act of love of self to be myself in every situation, circumstance, no matter what. That's an act of love of self. All right? But in terms of sharing myself and my experience with somebody else, that greatly is determined by their response to what I do. So I need discernment under those circumstances. So, for example, I'll give you an example. I am myself in front of you, right? But to be frank with you, I would not share my emotional experiences that I'm going through right now with the majority of you. Because the way you've got too much judgment. You know, for me to love myself, I only want to share my emotional experience with people who don't have as much judgment as you have. Now, you have that amount of judgment with yourself, so of course you're going to have judgment with somebody else. So I don't want to share my emotional experience with you while you've got all this judgment of me, but I still can be myself right now without the expectation of you sharing anything of mine. Can you see the difference? Now, it's an act of love of self to restrict your sharing of yourself to others who match or exceed your own condition of love. You see that? So in the first century, I'd just been belted with whips for quite some time, and I was taken before Pilate, and he wanted to question me some more. And he'd just belted the hell out of me. So when he questioned me some more, I remained silent. Why? Because he'd just proven to me that he had no interest in me, no interest in my welfare, right? But if he hadn't done that, I would have talked to him some more. Does that make sense? And you would be sensitive to the difference when you're in the situation. Okay, what else do we need to do to be ourselves? Well, if I'm only one half of self, then obviously to be myself at some point I have to connect with the other half of myself and be myself there. Does that make sense? So accepting and connect to other half of soul, right? Now, what does that mean? It means that I'd be focused on right now doing whatever I can to remove any blockages I have towards my soulmate, Mary. I won't be holding on to my crap and punishing her and doing a whole heap of other things on purpose. I'll be looking at this as, no, we need to grow. Our soul is an I. I need to grow. I need to grow. Any growth I achieve, Mary will feel benefited by. That's an act of love, isn't it? From me to her. She'll be benefited by my growth. I'll be benefited by hers. If she decides to grow, it's an act of love towards me. Anything that stops us from growing towards each other needs to be addressed. Now, in the moment. Right now. So quite frequently you see me and Mary having conversations where we look like we're a pretty detailed conversation about something, right? Even in the group. That's because there's an issue right now, we need to address it. But what I see you guys doing is go, yeah, there's an issue, that went past. There's another issue, that went past in your relationship, that went past. And by the end of the week, there's like 25 issues that have been stored up. And what do you think's happening now? now you're bitter and angry and resistive towards each other, and that's not going to work, is it? So how do you address this? You address this by addressing the situation now. Addressing your blockage now. Talking about the situation now. Addressing the emotion now. But most of us want to put off all that, so we put it off. But you can't grow towards your soulmate by putting things off. If your love of God is number one and your love of self is number two, and self includes the other half of self, love of self should be displayed through what you do and how much time you spend working towards all of your blockages with each other, should it not? So if you again look at your time that you spend, how much time do you spend talking with each other, working through with each other your emotional blockages towards each other? Is it like in proportion to the priority system that we outlined at the beginning of this talk, or is it out of proportion to that? It's like, if it's like once a week or once a month or only when you get angry, then your priority isn't to love self. You're avoiding self. You're not addressing issues or situations. You're sitting on them. And it takes, sometimes you're going to have to risk some things, quite often, well, a lot of things, to raise an issue with your partner if you know that it always makes them upset or always makes them angry or whatever. You're going to have to risk quite a lot there, and that's going to help you a lot deal with your issues of addictions and so forth as well. Right? But it's a part of being you. Being you means you and the other half of you, you're sorting out your issues. Now, many of you don't know if you're with your soulmates. It doesn't matter. You think the person you're with is your soulmate, then do the same thing. Sooner or later, it will become evident. Sooner or later, once both of you get to the terror and you've released that, you'll start to feel your personality and nature, and you'll be able to feel if you're different or the same. You will. But you're not going to do that if you don't be each other, yourself, with each other. If you don't address the addictions and angers and frustrations that you've got going on with each other, you're not going to be like that with each other, are you? Can you see? So this is an essential requirement of you being you, just allowing yourself to deal with these issues in the situation. So we might be going and doing something, you know, like going to a movie, doing something we enjoy, and then all of a sudden an issue comes up. We don't say, oh, let's both decide to put that off till tomorrow. How crazy is that? They deal with it now. I'll stop the car, pull over. If it means we're late, we have to ring people, cancel that. Ring, do this, cancel that. We deal with this situation now. That's when we're dealing with it. No other time. To be you, you have to live in the now. And that means addressing a situation now. Trying to correct issues now. Now, some issues will take longer than now to correct. So you have patience with each other about that, right? But you don't allow it to go on for years and years and years, because that means one or both of you are not loving the other, right? You deal with things now. A person who's being their loving self addresses things now. It's so nice. To address things now, Tara, you'd like to ask.
I have the opportunity to feel overwhelmed pretty much every second of the day when everyone's at home. I'm just wondering.
Can I stop your story and get to the question?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Is it more important to feel the overwhelm with five different things going on from five different people, just go away, feel the overall overwhelm, and then each different individual thing.
Can I suggest, Tara, you've got five things going on with five different people because you're in addiction with five people. A person who is not in addiction never has five different things going on with five people at the same time. They never do. I never do. I have a thing going on with one person, then a thing going on with the other. I don't have one thing going on with all these different people, all these different situations. You're doing that because you're meeting the addictions of each other frequently, and everyone then has expectations and demands that you're now accepting. And that's all because you're not addressing these issues.
Yeah. So even though it's not actually, like say Liam might be, you know, getting cranky at Zia, and I'm not wanting that to happen, so that's an addiction, because I want peace and harmony. And then the teenager, you know, Isaac will project something at Noah, and then Tayo does something. That's all happening at the same time, but that's all...
Your creation.
Yes, I know it's my creation,
no,
but
you
it's
don't.
All addiction.
No, you don't.
Okay.
Because you haven't dealt with the addiction. If you dealt with the addiction, then you would know it's your creation. Okay. At the moment, you think it's not dealt with, it's not your addiction.
No, because I want to blame. I want to blame everyone for
them
doing the unloving.
Anger and rage gets triggered. This is an indication your addiction's not getting met, and you're not addressing it as an addiction. You think you've got to solve the issue.
Yes.
So you involve all your addictions in trying to solve all these issues, addictions to be a good mum, and all these other issues come up. And these kind of situations only occur because of addiction, where everything ramps up, where everything's getting at you. Those things never happen if you have dealt with your addiction. They just don't happen. You have interactions that are pure. Like so for example, if I'm talking to you face to face, the phone rings. I don't answer it.
Yeah.
You do. Why? Because you're in addiction. Otherwise, you'd be loving the person you're with rather than worrying about who is on the phone. You'd be in that interaction with the person.
Right.
And the only time that would be different is if you'd arrange somebody to call at a certain time. That's the only time that you'd break that rule, right? But we're in addiction all the time. I see the majority of you with your little handheld devices, you know, all looking at them and wanting the interactions with people. Many of you, how many of you on Facebook? Facebook people, please put up your hands. Yeah, all addiction. And you just don't care. You want the addiction that meets your addiction. You follow me? So you're there involved in these processes constantly because you want, and there's now mega industries like Facebook that are just about feeding people's addiction. That's all they're for. And your life becomes more confusing. That's the penalty of breaking God's laws and meeting addictions.
Yeah.
Your life becomes more confusing, more difficult, harder to manage. The people around you become harder to manage. Your children become harder to manage. They become more influenced by spirits and others. Everything turns to crap because of this. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Because I've been thinking it's an addiction to peace and harmony, knowing that I've got lots of anger in me, but it could be just...
There's a lot
so
of different
many,
addictions.
So
there.
Many.
Yeah. Lots of different, and you need to identify them. Mary's given you plenty of advice on the subject,
yeah.
Tara, and you completely ignore it all the time. So, you know, yeah. Okay, so can you see that this connection to the other half, and here we're talking about mostly this connection, is about allowing yourself to be yourself with each other. When you're together with somebody, you be yourself with each other and you address issues as they arise, not later, as they arise. Now, there's moments in time where that might not be able to happen, but they'll be rare. They'll be rare. You'll be focused on trying to address the issue. Does that make sense? Every time. That's a part of you being you because it's a part of the two of you joining. It's essential for your own happiness and theirs. So it's an essential part of you being you. Two of you joining at some point in the future. Anyway, I've gone over time as I usually have. Sorry about that again. And there's no Q&A about this topic either. So I'd like you to have a think about the questions you might have about this subject. And when you've got those questions, send them in. And we can address them when we do different Q&As over the course of the following year. So hopefully, after all that, you've learnt how to develop you and how to be you. And you've got, from yesterday, God's gifts to be you and God's gifts that he gave you, the creation of your real self, so you've got some idea or concept about what is the real you. And so if you add those two things together, now you can start to develop or become your loving self through that process. And if you add that to the previous things we talked about in terms of removing your unloving self, you can see that the combined effect is going to be that you have a much higher likelihood of connecting to God as the real you, receiving God's love and therefore God's education in love. Wonderful. Yeah. All right, well, let's have a 10-minute break now. And so we come back at 3:10 and we'll have our last discussion with you.